Hi, let's talk about the kidneys. Here I have a collection of plastinated and plastinated pathological kidneys for us to explore. So in my hand here is a left kidney, and if I were to open this up, this has been coronally sectioned, we can see the difference between the cortex and the medulla of the parenchyma, that metabolically active portion of the kidney. The cortex is largely superficial, and it descends between the regions of the medulla in columns. The medulla, or the regions of the medulla, are referred to as pyramids or renal pyramids. It's probably a bad name because they're actually conical in shape. Now the nephrons, which are the functional units of the kidneys, they actually sit between the medulla and the cortex, and the nephron loops descend deep into the medulla, and then the collecting ducts for urine drain to the end of the pyramids in regions called renal papillae. These renal papillae are surrounded by minor calyces. The minor calyces coalesce into major calyces, and the major calyces coalesce into the renal pelvis, which then feeds into the ureter, which then conducts urine down to the urinary bladder. Now here I have a specimen which has both the right and the left kidney, as well as the inferior vena cava. Now remember that the left renal vein is substantially longer than the right renal vein, and this is what is in jeopardy of compression between the aorta and the superior mesenteric artery. These kidneys have been injected with latex, and so if we open them up, we can see the pathways by which the arterial and venous supply of blood take. And you'll notice that the areas most devoid of latex are the renal pyramids. And that's because the vasculature that conducts blood out to the nephrons, namely things like the interlobar arteries, the arcuate arteries, the cortical radiate arteries, the afferent arterioles, are all contained within the cortex. The paratubular capillaries, which surround most of the nephron, are also largely in the cortex. There are some paratubular capillaries and vasa recti that make it into the medulla, but these typically have very, very narrow lumen, and so the latex doesn't penetrate as well. I've also brought a couple of pathological specimens of kidneys for us to see. This first is an example of polycystic kidney disease. And with polycystic kidney disease, an individual may have one or multiple, and in the case of this individual, they have very many vesicular cysts over the surface of the kidney. Now, as you can imagine, this can be quite destructive to the parenchyma and diminish the kidney's ability to serve as a dynamic filter of blood over time. I've also brought an example of a horseshoe kidney. Kidneys actually develop within the pelvic cavity, and then they ascend superiorly to the retroperitoneum of the abdominal cavity, quite high. In some cases, as kidneys develop, they fail to separate from one another, and they stay fused. And that condition, and this is a prime example of one, is known as a horseshoe kidney. And with the horseshoe kidney, as it ascends, it becomes caught on the inferior mesenteric artery and can't reach its typical position in the retroperitoneum. And as a result, the horseshoe kidney sits very low within the abdominal retroperitoneum. The kidney parenchyma is still fully functional, and so without being discovered as an incidental finding of image or surgery, an individual may go their entire life without realizing they have a horseshoe kidney. Finally, here I have a very interesting specimen. What you're seeing before you is the pelvis of an individual. Here you can see the urinary bladder. This would be the psoas major muscle on either side. Here's the ureter descending down. There's the inferior vena cava, and this is the abdominal aorta splitting into the common iliac arteries. And right here is a kidney where a kidney is not typically found. And this is an example of an ectopic kidney. Anytime a structure is ectopic, that means it's found outside of the borders of where it would typically reside. Now, this particular kidney is in an interesting place because when people perform kidney transplants, they oftentimes will anchor the kidney to this very location so that they can have prime access to the iliac vasculature. So you have a very strong flow of blood through this common iliac artery, and you can attach the renal artery to the common iliac artery and the renal vein to the common iliac vein, and it's just a short trip to the urinary bladder from there. So we've talked a little bit about the kidney and its gross morphology and some of the pathologies which may affect the kidney. Thank you.